Lawrence, in many ways, the last year has been the great equalizer in some way, hasn't it?
Well, we've seen a complete change in the tectonics of both economics and geopolitics, with the rise of China, India, the BRIC countries, Brazil, Russia, and of course with the G20 now having a voice. The thing is whether this change is significant enough, whether it's actually deep enough. We had at the G20 meeting last week, the U.S. government put forward a proposal that the other 12 countries outside of the G8 should be governed by IMF administrative rules and supervision. Mm-hmm. I find that really amazing that the IMF is going to be governing those countries when we in Wall Street, after our massive bailout of banks and financial institutions, are now giving super bonuses to CEOs and to fund managers. Shouldn't the IMF be looking over Wall Street? I think that's where they should be, not looking over China and New Delhi. That's not.
You know, we've gone from the G8 to the G20. That's a plus. You know,
right.
This is a tacit acknowledgement that we have to be more pluralistic and inclusive in the world order today. But it's just what you just said there about the IMF. We're kind of relying on these old institutions, the old standbys, for oversight and looking to them for leadership, and yet the world is changing around us. Is that what I'm reading here?
The world's changing. Those institutions are not keeping up. We in the States, we elected Barack Obama. We called for change. Well, he represents change, but the institutions around him have not changed. They are not keeping up. They're falling back in the old ways, and that's how empires crack, fall, and get left behind. That's how new empires rise, and we see this happening right now around us. I mean, we look at history. History is repeating itself. And you have institutions like the IMF and World Bank. They are not concurrent with change. You have the Chiang Mai Initiative that represents a regional response to the failures of the IMF. It's because of the hindsight of the 1997 Asian financial crisis that China, Japan, Korea, and ASEAN were able to respond with their own stabilization currency fund for the region. And I think that's what we're going to see. We're going to see a shift from the sort of Washington consensus, World Bank, IMF, WTO, these type of vehicles as the governing platform of our global financial markets and economic institutions. And we're going to see it shift to regions. We're seeing it already in Asia. Asia's response has been the fastest, the quickest. And of course, the Asian economies have survived this crisis better than anywhere else. Mm-hmm. We're also going to see it in Latin America. I think we're going to see it in Africa. Mm-hmm. The regional response, regionalism, will be the antithesis of the globalization.
Okay, what is the replacement, or what is the opposite alternative to, an IMF or World Bank-led initiative? We do have the ADB, which is, of course,
ADB is just a mirror image of the IMF and World Bank. It's also a failed institution.
What are the alternatives? We need
new institutions, frankly. Uh-huh. I mean, the Chiang Mai Initiative is a step in the right direction. Uh-huh. We need regional institutions with regional players. I mean, the Asian Development Bank's largest players, of course, the U.S., and so, of course, it's influenced from the West. It's not influenced from Asia. We need, in Asia, we need Asian solutions for our own problems. We don't need solutions from the outside. I often say, how can you have consultants from the IMF and World Bank fly into a country and advise on village economics when those consultants have actually never spent a night in a village?
No, but it's not every, back in the day, when Dr. Mahathir was ruling Malaysia, they talked about an East Asia trading bloc or economic bloc. And, it kind of fell apart because there were so many vested interests that they just couldn't really overcome the differences. We know in the world of microfinance, I mean, Muhammad Yunus is a brilliant, brilliant mind, but they only come once a generation. There's only one or two of them per generation. Every country does not have a Muhammad Yunus at its disposal.
But I think times are changing right now. I think what has happened in the 1997 period is China was not, it was, in the state of reform. It was not a rising economic superpower. Yeah. And now you have a shift with China, India, with the developing countries having the economic clout to be able to set policy. Okay. And that's what's different.
All right. You remember you're talking about the bonuses on Wall Street?
That's right.
Okay. Try to keep your temper under control. I need to give you a chill pill because that's exactly what we're going to hear about next. Still to come.